to see the team really shake Dublin, and Dublin looked a shadow of themselves, not just because they're a wee bit out of form, but even whenever Tyrone had them on the ropes. And in that final 20 minutes, where you always expected, and we've got used to Dublin in all the league games, just always been able to make a game of it, even whenever they're not playing particularly well, they looked flat and they looked beat from 15, 20 minutes out, which was stunning to see. So from a Tyrone point of view, really, really positive. I suppose the biggest thing is we seem to be bringing something very different, and it's something that really seems to work against Dublin. So I think that's a source of great encouragement.
Yeah, just explain to us a little bit about what difference there is in terms of how the game plan is being implemented, because it looked like a very different style of play that they were espousing.
Yeah, so really from about the third game, all of the leagues have been trying to go more man-to-man and with less of a sort of a retreat into the blanket fence. In the first two or three games, they were off colour, although like Dublin, they were only coming back from holiday. But then they pivoted Matty Donnelly right into full forward, and increasingly now the last couple of games, Callum McShane up along with them. They pulled Petey Hart, who was at full forward, pulled him more out round the middle again to more an attacking, and they've now blended sort of their old sort of good compact defence and sort of breaking out of that defence, but with two target men, old fashioned target men inside, and they're releasing the ball in early. The amount of kick passing Tyrone have been doing right from the start of the league has been really, really notable whenever you compare it with how they've played over the years. So there's been a huge increase in long kick passing, and you've seen that to really excellent effect again Dublin. The issue with Dublin is most teams play at least a sweeper back there. Dublin tend not to. They tend to drop Kane O'Sullivan quite late whenever a team is attacking, presuming that they're going to attack through the hands. But Tyrone, with the much faster attack, with the long kick passing, worked a treat, and with the two big men, Matty Donnelly and Cal McShane in there, they were winning ball. Sometimes it didn't work out, but when it did work, there was scores to be had. And if it didn't work out, the ball was coming back out, but Tyrone were still largely in their defensive shape. So there was a double bonus from a Tyrone point of view.
I think the benefit of having McShane and Matty Donnelly is that they can both come deep if they need to and win their own ball deep. And so what I'm trying to get at here is that they don't just provide a single challenge. They're not just two big men on the edge of the square. They will travel out if they need to, but when they need to be big men on the edge of the square, they can do that. So they're kind of a multi-platform approach.
Yeah, absolutely. They are much more, really, both players. If you had a very natural forward line, both players would probably be more out around the middle of the field. And with Tyrone have lots of runners through that middle third. They've a couple of good new midfielders that they're discovering, and that has released options for Mickey to maybe move them men up the field and still keep a platform in the middle. But you're absolutely right, and at times it did happen, and Dublin, nearly all teams do it now, that at times you still have to get back. You're still tracking men back, and Dublin still have threatening defenders if they're allowed to attack. So Matty or Cahill can track back. They're well capable of covering large amounts of ground, so they can do that. But you did see them, whenever they did get back, there was a concerted effort to get up the pitch, get well ahead of the ball, so that they were that option.
Yeah, where did this come from, do you think? Because Mickey's style has been Mickey's style effectively with a few iterations over the last decade and a half. This seems like quite a departure, and it felt like it kind of came in the middle of the league in some ways.
Yeah, well, I know that Tyrone have been trying to work on their forward system, and the work last year with Mark Bradley was sort of their main man inside, but that didn't really allow them this type of option. I know Stephen O'Neill is obviously the fella in there who's charged with doing a good part of the attacking work, and to be fair, there was parts of that game on Saturday evening that I just remembered how we were instructed to make the passes to Stevie, or how Stevie wanted the passes. There were some passes made completely blind where the forward hadn't made the run, but the ball was hit. Hampshire's ball was like that. There was another one or two as well where the kick pass was struck before the forward actually moved, but the forward was going to move to the D, and the defenders were through. So that's always how we used to try and hit Stevie, because you just knew that was his movement. So I don't know whether it's his influence really starting to come home to bear. I would imagine it's multiple things. It's Tyrone realising that last year's style didn't work, and so trying to force something different. It's the freedom of now having Matty and Cahill in there to be able to have them options, and then the boys going with that more attacking thing and getting the ball into the forwards much, much faster. Like, the joke was, I suppose you couldn't really work on a forward line whenever you had only one forward up, so that has been tweaked. Earlier on in the league, they did try to keep three or four up, and it still wasn't really working. But now with the two big men as sort of a pivot, and they're not always there. Sometimes that's Petey Hart. Sometimes there's just one of them. But there's usually always an option in there of a true ball winner in the full forward line. But right across the pitch, you had big performances from Tyrone. I thought Tyrone's defence was outstanding against Dublin. A lot of focus has been on that attacking play. But Tyrone's defence, instead of having the blanket defence, they were largely man-to-man, and they were excellent. You had Ben McDonald of Mohun Club, Eric Kieran. He was largely picking up Kieran Kilkenny. This is Ben's first, only his third start for Tyrone. And yet he was picking up Kieran Kilkenny, done a great job on him. You had Brian Kennedy, again, new in this year. He was picking up Fenton and done a great job on him. Now, yes, them Dublin players were off colour, but still, for them young Tyrone players to come in and do essentially man-to-man jobs, not a blanket defence job, but man-to-man jobs, I think that's hugely encouraging. As much as the forward play is encouraging, Tyrone were hugely solid in defence. Tyrone missed quite a bit up front, that quite a few attacks that didn't work out. It was because they were so solid defensively. Now Dublin missed a right bit too, in fairness, but because Tyrone were very, very good defensively, that was still the foundation to allow the forward play to flourish.
Just a last bit about this, the midfield, obviously you know exactly what Mickey wants from midfielders. What has the discovery of the new midfielders, how has that allowed them to push Matty forward? What's he looking for from his midfielders in the system?
He's looking for boys that can compete in the air. So I suppose the modern midfielder is very, very different from previously, where the main job was to be a fetcher of ball or a creating of good break ball that you could win it and not get dominated in the middle against other midfielders. Now it's so much more of a running game. So the midfielders that Mickey would be looking is they would really have to be switched on. At times they can be very quiet, you mightn't spot them, but they're the ones that have to be, I would imagine, seeing the danger, spotting the danger. They're your utility players. They would have a freedom that if they see an opportunity to attack, but they're also the ones that if defenders have bombed forward, they're the ones that have to be looking their head on the pivot the whole time to look for the gaps, look for the dangers, get talking and do whatever needs to be done. So they have to sacrifice themselves for the team, add a wee bit into the attack if needs be, but they have to sacrifice for the team. You've seen it none better than Colm Cadden over the past few years, where he always looks for the danger. He looks where he's needed from a team point of view to keep the team solid and allow maybe the other team, the other players, the freedom to bomb if they see the chances, because they know they're always covered.
From what you've seen in the league so far this year, and I guess over the last 12 months as well, and do you think that is the most important characteristic of a modern-day midfielder, the awareness, the ability to read the game, and ultimately an ability to man-mark?
Yeah, you have to be able to be that sort of the traditional centre-half back. You have to, from a midfield point of view, you have to be both an ability. Usually as a midfielder, if you were lining up for a kick-out, you were the main man and you were the dominant one. You could decide where you ran and everybody else had to sort of either create space for you or that. Midfielders now are part of a whole system where they might have to run to create space for somebody else. You have to be a player with huge awareness, whereas the midfielders of old, they were the totem poles the teams were built around, and they were the generals in the midfield along with, say, the centre-half back, and they sort of were very dominant figures. The midfielders now tend to be just all action. They will be attacking, they'll be defending, they'll be filling in gaps, but they're no longer the real totem poles as such in a team that a team is built around. So the modern midfielder, the big fetches, is such a tiny part of the game that old style midfield probably isn't valid or certainly important anymore. You have to have a really good head on your shoulders, and you're just one chink in the team in the chain, rather than maybe a very focal point where the midfielders of old were.
Yeah, it's an interesting kind of idea, because you look at Aidan O'Shea's performance on Saturday night, brilliant around the middle of the park. Has he now got that ability to read a game better than he used to?
Well, again, he's played just about everywhere from full-back to full-forward. So, again, he's going to be acutely aware. Now, Aidan O'Shea is a different... That he's a unique player. Aidan O'Shea, when he walks into the dressing room, is a different player. He just attracts attention, and he is just a very, very charismatic player, same as Michael Murphy from Galway. So some players just have that anyway, and they are key leading players within a team, and teams will always rally around them. That's the way. Now, wherever they're positioned, if they're midfielder, they're still going to be a key man for the team. But in Mayo, no less than anywhere else, you need to be that link where you're covering and filling in. If you want your defenders to attack properly as a midfielder, you're going to have to watch and always judge, are you needed up there? With being Aidan O'Shea, he is needed. He is going to have to join, so other boys will be covering for him. So I'd imagine it's different for the likes of Aidan O'Shea than it is for a Brian Kennedy of Tyrone. Interestingly, thinking of that key man analogy, I've always sort of said Dublin's strength in terms of their attacking play is that in terms of their six forwards, they're not reliant on a real star man. It's everybody is so good in there that everybody's their own star man and everybody's worth a watching. But it was interesting on Saturday night, for the first time, you could see the fact that they were missing, whenever the team was misfiring, the fact that they were missing that go-to player, that player with something different, that player who was their on-field leader, they were missing that star to sort of go to. Whenever the team was struggling, you get your star of the ball and they'll work something. You know it's safe with them. And so you just look at who they're missing and you sort of think again, Jim Gavin is now in a situation he would never have thought he would be in. So from a Tyrone point of view, you were saying at the start that we're delighted with the win. Absolutely. Have we woken the beast? Possibly. Will Jim Gavin start looking at his options that are playing club football in Dublin at the minute? He very likely will. But
do you mean Diarmuid Connolly?
Yeah,
are you talking Diarmuid Connolly?
Pardon?
Are you talking about Diarmuid Connolly?
Yeah, I think the likes of Connolly, possibly the likes of Rory O'Carroll, though I think he's further away from the mix. But I just thought that Dublin forward line on Sunday, and funny, a good friend of mine, Stevie Quinn, mentioned to me, they were missing that go-to player. Whenever the rest of them were struggling, you just love to have that go-to player that you just know he's got something else and that really, really isn't capable of being man-marked. And Diarmuid Connolly is certainly a very obvious candidate for that type of role.
Yeah, I think it makes a lot of sense. And one last thing, it seems like the team are really well set up for next season. And I don't want to blah, blah, blah away this year, but if the rule changes come in the way they are for the league, or at least if the advanced mark does, then all of a sudden having those two big lads in the full forward line who can fetch ball anywhere between the goal line and the 40 is going to be a massive godsend to a team like Tyrone, because all of a sudden they can do anything to you.
Yeah, absolutely. And I suppose I'd pull away from that, and that people are saying, oh, it's the forward marks making these people kick in the long ball. Any player that has played any football over the past 40 years will know that one of the best tactics in Gaelic football is always kick it into your full forward line, especially if you have ball winners there. That was before any forward mark was there, if you know what I mean. So
yeah,
all them passes, whether the forward mark is used or not, are still hugely effective, because if that ball's won in there, you've got, in rugby parlance, you've got great field position. So the forward mark, I still don't like whenever these great attacks, great kick pass, great fetch, and then the player stops for a free kick at goals. I still don't like that, to be honest, but I still think that the long forward kick passing is going to be the main way to, by the looks of it, that you can attack Dublin. Of course, the obvious tactical move to go against that is to start bringing back sweepers. And that sort of is almost bringing us back to full circle. So if this is a new sort of tactical move that the game's going in, it is an old tactical move where sweepers came from. So we'll see how teams adapt it over the summer. But it's certainly at least great to see that Dublin can be shook.
Yeah, and great stuff. Thanks for joining us this morning.
All right.